Chịp xuống bóng ôn là lần này nhóm nào chụp cho mùi bóng ôn cho mùi mật phẹt con đọc nhóm nâng cho mùi Rola. Hãy nhóm nâng ai kê introduce herself a little bit đọc mấy ai bóng ôn score. Nên đã tha thả lọc bản mơ video nhóm bì môn Rola was also on my videos posting a couple months ago. And today I am here to talk to her, you know, share with you some of the things that she is going through to become a teacher, because she's going to be a teacher very soon. And this is what I'm gonna let her introduce herself a little bit. Are you ready, yeah. Rola? Okay, I'm gonna turn the camera to her. Okay, here you go, Rola.
Hi, nice to see you again. My name is Rola, and I'm currently a senior in college for education, specifically bio and general science. As of right now, I'm taking a few classes on special education and for my practicum course, where I go into classrooms and actually experience, observe, and like teach students.
Okay, so you're gonna be done this year in May,
yep,
June?
In May.
In May, okay. Yep. So let me just say to the viewer, okay, Bomb On, I just want to let you know that a lot of you who want to learn English, okay, and some of you are learning, okay, which is really good. What I have here is that Rola, her English is very good. And if you're able to understand her, okay, she's a student, a university student, a college student that's going to school for teaching, as you all heard. And this is, you know, a very good opportunity for all of you to practice your listening skill, okay? If you're able to understand her, meaning your English skill is really good, meaning your proficiency is really good. Now, here's the thing. I'm gonna ask her some questions and I'm gonna turn the camera to her. You're probably gonna hear me in the background, just my voice, but I want to focus so that you can see her, okay? Bong po'on, na ni khnyom chang nai nom bong po'on tae Rola. Rola nang kot kampong tae rien thua kru. Kot rien nao sala maha vichy lai. Alo chnam ni chnam ti buon nai. Chi chap chnam mok nang ai bong po'on. Alo ni khnyom nang sua kot kla. Hai bong po'on jump stop her. Like I'm gonna ask her some questions. Things that she does to prepare herself to be a teacher. What are some of the things, okay? Let's see, Rola. Okay, Rola. Now, as a student at the college, okay, what are some of the challenges that you find yourself like with schooling?
Okay, so like regular academic-wise, so studying is definitely one, staying on top of your game.
When you say on top of your game, what does that mean?
Kind of like following through with like a study plan or a schedule and being responsible for your own study. So for me, I am specialized in biology and general science. So I take a lot of like natural science course, physics, physical science. And with that, it could be like pretty content heavy, so I would have to like plan out all my study days and ensuring that I actually followed through to get that done. And for my education side, I would say like some of the challenges that I've encountered would be like the process of the system, not with like getting things done, more like the school's end, because depending on where you go, your school system might be really well put together, or some other ones might not be. As for me, in my experience, I've had some trouble with like the actual program. So it took nearly a year for them to process my application to the Feinstein School, which is an education program at Rhode Island College, for me to get into that program. And if I didn't get into that program, wouldn't be able to graduate on time or take certain classes. So I had a hard time with that. Communication was one of the biggest challenges, because a lot of like the associate like deans and like the actual chair of the program wouldn't respond to you. So you would have to be like really proactive about it.
So the word here is proactive. When you are being proactive, meaning what you need to do.
So you have to like reach out yourself, step up, make connections, things like that.
So you have to take a lot of the actions upon yourself in order to get responses.
Okay. And that goes the same with practicum. Like, for my practicum courses, working with kids can be challenging. You can't just, like, sit there and observe. If you want to know more, you have to be proactive. Talk with your cooperating teacher and, like, your students, trying to get to know them more. And, like, learn the classroom environment, how things are ran in the classroom.
Now, Rola, when you were taking classes, or still taking classes mm-hmm. now, how, like, each semester, how many classes do you usually have to register for or take?
For the semesters, like the regular fall spring semester, I usually do typically 5. Rarely I do 4.
Are they all like 3 credits or 4 credits?
4 credits. I try to max out my credits. Mm-hmm. And during the summer, I've never taken a summer break, so I've been taking classes all summer. Wow. Mm-hmm. And each summer I either do 8 credits to 12 credits. I remember last summer I had 4 classes, so roughly about 16 credits.
That's a lot.
Yep,
I do the summer, like almost a full time.
Yep, I did full time during the summer. And then the previous semester in springtime, I had to get an override for credits because I had over 18 credits. I did roughly about 24 credits mm-hmm. in one semester, so that was about like 7 classes. Mm-hmm. That's just to max out my time so that I can graduate on time. There's a lot of classes that needs to be taken, and with my program being like a new program, they keep adding more classes. Mm-hmm. So, which that sucks because I'm the first one, like I'm part of the group that
cohort.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That takes the class for the first time. So we're like the tester.
The experimenting.
Guinea pigs kind of.
Guinea pigs, the yep. experimenting group.
So we're taking those classes, and then it's hard because the professors are trying to learn how this class performs, and the students are also like testing with it. Mm-hmm. But so with all these new classes added, we basically had to take a lot of classes. Personally, I took a lot of courses. Mainly because some of these courses were something I was interested in, so I took them upon myself. But other than that, I would say roughly a semester is about 4 classes, like 12 credits mm-hmm. to 15. That's like a regular medium.
Okay. Do you have to take a special ed classes as well?
Yeah, so for my education program, mm-hmm. I think it's most of Rhode Island, like all of Rhode Island anyway. Mm-hmm. You have to either choose a track where you specialize in like special ed or ESL. Mm-hmm. So I decided to do special ed mm-hmm. instead of ESL personally because I like it more. So it's 2 semesters, so 1 year worth of special education course. So currently I'm enrolled in a special education course.
Mm-hmm. Now for the teaching program at RIC, do you have to take like a test to get into the program?
I wouldn't say you have to take a test, more like requirements that you did in high school. So for example, as long as you hit all the requirements, you can apply and get into the program. But you have to keep in mind that you have to maintain like grades. So like high school wise, you would have taken your SAT at some point, and the SAT score, it has to be either within the range or like close to the conditional range. And then if you're in the conditional range, you would have to take a course to make up for it. And then you can apply. And then for your GPA, you have to maintain it. Mm-hmm. I think at RIC is 2.75 GPA, but
2.75?
Yeah.
Okay.
To me, I feel like that's relatively low. Mm-hmm.
Is that a B minus?
I think so.
Okay,
yeah.
B minus GPA.
Yep.
Now, what would you recommend for people if they are interested in going into education?
Recommendation.
Mm-hmm. Would you recommend people to go into education or would you say, maybe do other?
I feel like definitely I would recommend you to go into education, but it is a lot of work. It is a lot. It is challenging. Mm-hmm. So for people who actually does want to go into education, you have to be strong-minded, strong-willed. You have to think for the good of others, definitely for children and for mm-hmm. the education system, like the evolved education system. Mm-hmm. Definitely not for the benefit of money, because there's more money with it.
What made you want to become a teacher or an educator?
So I was initially like kind of like a pre-med track. So pre-med, pre-optometry. Like, I really wanted to do something with optometry.
So what happened?
But mainly because it was bio-related. Mm-hmm. And I, like, have a passion for bio ever since, like, high school. Like, I've always liked science. Mm-hmm. But at some point, I feel like the medicine side didn't, like, I lost
interest.
I fell out of love for medicine. So I mainly still focused on biology, and I didn't know what to do with it. I didn't want to be in a lab all day long. So it's like, oh, maybe like teaching can be like something that I'm interested in, because I get to like learn more about the science and also be able to teach the science to the generations after us.
I think, to be honest with you, the world needs more teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you would be a great teacher too, you know, because you love science. So you, you know, do you want to be a science teacher, like a biologist teacher, since you are so interested in biology?
My main program is biology education, but I'm also doing general science so that if there's a need, because I know if you're going to get hired at a district, they're not going to make you only teach biology. There's definitely other courses that you have to teach, such as anatomy, like forensics.
What is your concentration? Like secondary ed? Or
secondary ed.
That's good. Okay, so
for
you could actually
high school
do,
level.
That's actually, you can be a science teacher.
Mm-hmm.
And I know with a science teacher, you can either teach biology, chemistry, or physiology, whatever the school needs you.
Yep, so like, for example, in my program, you would have to pick like the natural sciences or the physical science. You would have to pick either one. So everybody does general science. No matter what, you have to do general science. But you would have to pick either physics, chemistry, or bio. And personally, I like life science, so bio it is.
Life science. We do a lot of life science in the elementary school because, you know, that's one of the things. That's
like the basics.
The basic.
Yep.
Learning about animals, learning about plants, you know, the life cycles and all of that. Okay, so I'm just like thinking, like, you as a student at the college, what would you recommend for a high schooler who want to become a teacher? What would you recommend them to do? Like, what once
prepare.
They
prepare?
How do
okay
they prepare? How would they have to, you know, get themselves to prepare for the classes or whatever?
For the classes, I would say, like, in high school, you definitely took, like, classes that you need, because it's like a general education. So if you know what you want to specialize in, at the secondary level, at least for specialization, just keep in mind that all the stuff that you've learned, you're gonna use them for sure. Because I have to take my praxis exam, two, and I have to take two different ones, for one for biology and one for general science, and that's basically everything that you've learned throughout your whole entire high school and college career, like all the science. It's for me, it's gonna cover topic on life science, technology, ethical uses of science, and then, like, you know, cell and molecular, and then, like, all these things. So know that these things are gonna be tested, even in math too. Everything that you learn, it's gonna be tested. Be prepared for those, and then also don't be afraid to, like, reach out, because there's a lot of support at school for you. You'll need them for sure. And also keep in contact with your high school teachers or any other teachers that you like, the teachers within the grade level that you want to teach, because they will be a great help.
The praxis, is it a requirement? Like, I know I heard a lot of the praxis. I had to take the praxis during our time, my time, you take the practice after you finish, okay, so that you are certified. Because in order to get your certificate, you need to pass the practice test.
Yep.
Now at the college, do they still do that, or do you have to take before?
We have to take it before. So for my program, it's before practicum, but because just recently they revamped the requirements and also revamped the test. So, like, the content, Praxis 2 content test, they revamped it. So, you would have to take it, like, the new test starts on September 1st. You would have to take it before practicum and student teaching, but because it's a new test, my program decided that it was fine if I take it as long as it's before student teaching, but I would have to get both done before I graduate to get certified and making sure that I graduate with a certificate that I can teach with. And as of right now, the PLT is currently canceled, so PLT, you don't have to take the
Principal
PLT.
Of Learning Teaching. Yes, I had to take the PLT.
PLT is for everyone.
Yeah. I took the PLT and then I took the content area for like
English
language, arts, science, social studies, math.
I had to take all of them. Yeah. The general science one too. Okay. Because you're like at elementary level, so you have to general science. Okay.
Correct. It was hard. First, the principle of learning and teaching for ESL particularly. And then afterwards, I had to go and do the content area tests, praxis. So in order to be certified, you have to pass. So now they require you to do before student teaching?
Yep, before student teaching, so that they know that you know your stuff. Like, teachers don't have to worry. Your cooperating teacher, your mentor, they don't have to worry about you not knowing your content because they don't have time to be teaching you if they're already mentoring you in how to run their classroom.
Now, as a student yourself, what is one thing that you like about the education program at school?
Let me think. I feel like I don't really have much to say on the positive end because I've been having a lot of trouble. But because our education program, especially in the science department, it's kind of not well put together, I would say.
And they're still in the testing mode at the moment, right? With the new cohort, with the experimenting, maybe that's why.
Why. So personally, my experience, it's not as well put together. It's even with the application process. But I would say, like,
have you voiced it to the department?
I've mentioned it to the chair. I've mentioned it to everyone. I've mentioned it to the whole entire education, the Feinstein School program, like department. And there's nothing I can do about it. So that's, I wish I could say good things about it, but it's kind of like hard to like pull something out.
You're gonna be graduating,
right? I'm gonna be graduating, and I feel like that's because I know I worked hard myself. Like, I try to do as much as I can, even without like the actual support that I was supposed to be getting, that your school is supposed to be providing you with. But
So when you went in to do your observations or practicum, you did, right? You went
in for my previous.
What do you like about the school setting?
It depends. I've been to different schools. So right now I'm at Cranston West, but which I haven't like gone in person yet, but at Woonsocket High School, the one that I went to previously, I would say like the staffs, at least the science department, they were really friendly and they're willing to help no matter what. I can ask for materials that they're doing for the class, and they're really accommodating. Usually if you ask them for tips or even like lessons on what they did, what you should not do as a teacher, it's really like they're really supportive. They have a supportive staff. But for the environment at the school, I would say like it depends on the school you go to, because all schools are different. And it also depends on the area. So like a low income area school, like students are gonna be more like, I don't want to say difficult, but it's more like
challenging.
Yeah,
more challenging.
Challenging.
Yeah. So it's depending on the demographic. Economic demographic of the
status.
School.
It's gonna be more challenging depending on the school that you go to, but it's different in every school. So.
Okay. Now, Rola, if you were to give advices to people who want to become a teacher, what's some things that you would tell them to do or not to do?
To do, definitely be proactive. Know what you want, get what you want. Don't be afraid to reach out. And not to do is slacking. Okay. Don't slack off, because everything's really like fast paced, especially with like the courses that you're taking. Everything goes by real quick. It's only like half a semester long, everything, and then you have to learn it all in a short time, so you can't like afford to fall behind.
Okay, the classes that you take at the university, if you were to scale it 1 through 10, 10 being the like very hard, like how challenging are the classes?
Overall or class by class?
Overall, like, you know, overall, so that people would, who are interested to become a teacher be prepared, especially now?
Okay.
You know? Because it's different than 20 years ago. Like, I don't want to say everything's so different. Now, yeah. I'm sure there's, you know, some things that are different.
So I would say, like, educational courses, for example, like secondary ed, elementary ed, and like special education, these type of courses, I would rate them like 5 or 6 out of 10, depending if you understand the concept or like what they're trying to like get across. And because these are like the general, like the introductory to like education. And one class would teach you on assessment, another class would teach you on like preparation, lesson planning, practicum. They prepare you for that. And then for content wise, because mine is science, I would say they're on like a scale of 8 or 9 out of 10.
Oh.
Yep. Okay. Unless you're like super intelligent. But yeah. But I had a few classes that were definitely challenging and I would never want to take again. But
really? What are they?
So genetics. Okay. Was one of the course that I struggled in. That was the only class that I had a C on.
Wow.
On my whole entire transcript. And I'm just like, okay, I'm not happy with it. But
only one C out of all the other classes. That's, you know, pretty good.
Uh-huh.
So it's like genetic class, like with science class.
Yeah, it's a science. For my content area, we're learning about genes, DNA, you know, cloning, ethical reasons.
And, cloning.
Yeah, and then I had to write a paper on CRISPR technology.
I don't even know what that is, CRISPR.
CRISPR is like a technology where they basically clone DNA.
Oh, okay.
And I remember there was a news article about this scientist.
Dolly?
Not Dolly.
That's the sheep, yeah.
That was not with CRISPR. Okay. I don't believe it was with CRISPR, at least. There was a scientist in China who basically created a human, a twin girls out of CRISPR.
Okay, I have to look into that. Mm-hmm. I've heard about it, but I did not know that was the scientist in China. I did not know that.
And currently, I think he's still held. Like, yeah.
He's still what?
I think he's in like serving. But I don't know if it's actually like if he's like actually serving or not, because I know he got in trouble for it,
For cloning a human being.
Well, not really cloning, I would say like just making one, like you're not supposed to like interfere with the nature. But
I thought science is supposed to be like
There's ethical reasons.
Yeah, there's ethical, but at the same time, you have to be open-minded. In order to like
you would have to be open-minded, but you also have to like share opinions with others, like these ethical reasons.
Yeah.
So you have to think about, like, for example, the guy who like made the children, the twin girls. Like, what are their lives gonna be like in the future? Like, if they do end up like living in society, like, what's gonna happen to them? So yeah, I'm getting ethical. Off topic.
Yeah.
But, yeah,
it's okay. Wow, thank you. Now, Rola. Is there anything that you want to add, like, as a newcomer, if a person come from another country and were to go into a university or a college to study, what are some things that you would, or advices would you give them?
A newcomer that would come for education.
They know how to speak the language, but they may not be as proficient as you.
Yep.
So what would your recommendation?
So it's kind of like my earlier recommendation about reaching out, because if language is something that can act as a barrier to your learning, to your education, reach out. There's definitely resources. Like at our school, we have... our school actually provides like translators and transcribers for students who have trouble like understanding... because they're like really accessible, really accommodating too. So that's one thing. And
so do they make it known?
Yep. So
at the college.
So we do have like a disability center. It's not like disability as in like, you know, like a broken limb or kind of like that.
No.
But anybody can use that resource. It's there for the student since you pay your tuition for it. Use the money that you paid.
Okay.
Yeah. So these things are accessible to you, and then also ask yourself this all the time. Where does your passion lie? Do you truly want to do it for the children? Do you truly want it? Like, do you really want to do this? Because it's
teaching
it's,
is a, yeah, it's a very lot. Challenging. It's, a lot.
It's a hard work. You work really hard for it. So you have to keep asking yourself that.
Do you really want this as for children or okay, whether they have the passion for it? Yeah, more like I see that some teachers, okay, I've seen it. Some teachers go into teaching, they think it's a an easy job, but then 1 or 2 years they quit. Okay, so I know you are not a teacher yet. You are studying to be a teacher. Do you feel worried or like?
I honestly am worried. So personally, I don't feel ready to start teaching even after graduating. So I plan on going to graduate school to learn more about like the science aspect rather than the pedagogy side. That's
so, just so you're thinking me. Of going into graduate school right after you. Okay.
Yep. But that's just personally like my what I personally want, because I feel like I wasn't really exposed to a lot of like the science end of science education. So I want more of the, you know, exposure to science, especially like my passion like for environmental science. That's where I really want to do right now, because you know,
environmental science,
that's where the future lies. Climate change so that's what I want to do. But if I would say like if you really are passionate and you think that teaching is what you really want to do, going straight into teaching after graduating is totally fine too, because there's you always have opportunities.
We do need teachers. I know a lot of districts need teachers. We are shortage of teachers now.
There's a shortage, especially in the STEM field.
Yeah, I know the STEM. Well, Rola, is there anything else you would like to add? I mean, like, I know through your years of schooling at the college, was there a time like you felt like, oh, like this is not for me?
Definitely. Especially, so I'm part of the crew that went through coronavirus, COVID. So we had hybrid classes or even just virtual classes. I didn't get to go to classrooms to observe for a lot of my classes that I was supposed to. I had to do things on my own. For example, getting volunteer hours, which is a requirement at my school because they couldn't set me up with one. So I had to get that done myself. And then like with all that going on and like being on an online school, like I wasn't learning as much as I wished as I hoped I would, but because it's not motivating. So motivation is one of them.
I think the pandemic really affected a lot.
Not just like college students,
but students themselves.
Students like, and even teachers, they feel burnt out because they weren't trained to do that in the beginning. Like as a public school teacher, like you aren't really trained to do everything virtual. So that's one thing, it affected everyone. Because of that, it was difficult for me, and I felt like I wasn't doing what I was supposed to do. Like, I felt like it was pointless just waking up in the morning, get online in my pajama, and just, like, sleep through the whole class. Guilty of that. So, yeah, that was, like, the worst part, and I felt like I wasn't doing, like, I feel like I wasn't getting the education that I was paying for.
Yeah, the pandemic really affected a lot of people.
Yep.
Okay, not just the people who are working in a regular job, but everyone were affected by
For sure.
The pandemic, you know, worldwide. That's why it's all over the world.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Rola. Is anything else that you would want to share with the viewers about studying in the college, preparing yourself to be a teacher or studying to be a teacher?
I don't think so. I think I said all I wanted. But study hard.
Study hard.
Be motivated.
Motivated.
And remember your passion. Remember why you started.
Okay.
Okay.
And in this case, your case is becoming a teacher or studying to be a teacher.
Yeah.
So nice. Let me just.
Okay.
Thank you so much.